you, sir?
Fine. How are you?
I'm fantastic, man. Congratulations on your nomination for The Life Ahead on Netflix.
Thank you so much. I'm so honored. It's so exciting. Thank you.
Well, talk about it. Talk about the feeling you have. Talk about being honored.
You know, what's really beautiful about making a movie like this, which we did with all of our hearts, all of our souls, when you get that heart back from the audience, or when you get that heart and that affection back from people who have seen it, and namely the Critics' Choice, it's just overwhelming. You know, the emotion that comes to mind to me is this deep sense of gratitude. That's really how I feel. I'm just so grateful.
No, thank you. Well deserved. Well deserved. It really is a fantastic movie. But the best part about it, you're the director, and you got a chance to work with your mother. Screen legend, superstar, Miss Sophia Loren. I mean, what was that like? I mean, that alone, no matter what you're making, is incredible. But you actually made a fantastic film. But talk about the experience of working with your mother, Sophia Loren.
So this is my third experience with my mother. It means we hated working with each other so much that we just did it a third time. Of course, I'm kidding. We loved working together so much that we just wanted to find another project to work on together. And you know what's great about working with one's mother is that I discovered the artist behind the mother. You know, a woman who at 86 years old could rest under the laurels of her legacy and not work again. But she's not like that because she's an artist. And that means that she likes to risk. That means that she likes to roll up her proverbial sleeves and dive back in and do something like the character of Madame Rosa in The Life Ahead, which is a very, very demanding character, both physically, because there are always so many children around, but also emotionally. And it's amazing to see this woman at her age being at the height of her powers, you know? And I think it's a wonderful example for everybody, you know, who, you know, society wants to tell us that when you reach a certain age, your better years are behind you. It's not true. It's a completely matter of choice. If you want to do something, every day is a new opportunity to have the best years of your life ahead of you.
Are you a filmmaker because of watching your mother in her career?
I'm a filmmaker because I'm in love with human beings and I'm in love with their journey.
When did you decide you wanted to become a filmmaker, and what led you to the trek that you're on now?
I don't think there was ever a time where I decided it. I think it was always in me. You know, I started with writing. I remember that I would just, you know, make up my brother's a concert pianist, so he's 4 years older than me. So when he was about 6 years old, he would play the piano in the living room, and I would sit at 2 years old on the carpet on the floor, and I would make up all these little scenes scored by his music. So really, there's never a time that, you know, and I would walk in a room and I would rearrange the light because I didn't feel the atmosphere was right. So it was always in me. But really what motivated me and what inspired me to tell stories is, as I said, you know, my passion for people, my passion for their journeys, my passion for their struggles, my passion to embrace these conflicts, to embrace what people have to go through to be seen, to be heard, to be themselves. That just inspires me endlessly.
The Life Ahead's a beautiful film. Why did you decide to tell this story, and why did you want to make this film?
Two reasons. You know, I fell in love with the book when I was 16 years old. And the two things that made me fall in love with the book were, A, the story of love and friendship in between these two people that everything separates, you know, race, religion, culture, age, and yet they're two opposite sides of the same coin. That was something that I found very, very beautiful, very inspiring. And the other thing was that Romain Gary, the author of the book, told the story through the point of view of this 12-year-old immigrant child. And I was so struck by that, you know, and I think we live in a world that is so polarized, and we all live in the silos of our own thoughts. And if anybody brings to the table a thought that might challenge yours, we find that a hostile act. And that's not the fact. We learn from understanding different points of view. And really the beginning of empathy is starting to see life through the eyes of other people. And this book did that. It told this world, it showed this world through the eyes of Momo. And I found that very compelling. And that's why we did the movie the way we did, which was absolutely exclusively through the eyes of this 12-year-old child.
Where'd you find the actor that plays the 12-year-old child? He's amazing.
I got lucky. I got lucky because I saw 350 children. And believe it or not, he was one of the first I saw. And every other child that would be brought to me and that I would start watching, I kept on thinking, yeah, but he doesn't have Ibra's heart. Yes, but there's not, you know, so he was amazing because he has Momo's light in the eyes, or what I always imagined Momo's light in the eyes would be. He has Momo's heart. He's a very generous young man. He's a very serious young man. He prepared extremely well. This is his first movie. And the first thing he told me, I gave him the part and he looked at me straight in the eyes and said, I'm going to give everything to this. Everything. Even just talking about it makes me emotional because I'm so proud of what he's done. My mother is not in every scene of this movie. He's in every scene of this movie. He is in every scene of this movie. And this is his first movie. And what he was able to do just through his sheer will, seriousness, preparation, so much hard work, but also his instincts. You know, I can do everything that I'm, as a director, you're a coach. But if the athlete in front of you can't do what I'm asking him to do, everything that it's useless. It doesn't mean a thing. And what was amazing were not only his talent, but just his little instincts. You know, he would do little things. Like, for example, I would rehearse with all the actors that he would be working with. So every weekend we would rehearse the scenes of that week. And every weekend we would have a different actor come in. And so I wanted him to be comfortable with these actors. So one weekend we worked with one actor, and as we were rehearsing, I found Ibra to be a little bit kind of low energy, and I let it go because we had a long week. And at the end of the rehearsal, I said, you know, it's funny, Ibra, because normally when we rehearse like this with new actors, you really give everything. You know, are you tired? Are you okay? And he's like, no, I'm fine. I'm fine. I said, so why didn't you give, you know, everything? And he said, well, I did that on purpose. And I was like, oh, why? And he said, because on the day when we're going to actually do the scene in front of the camera, and I do what I'm going to do in front of the actor, he's going to be really surprised. And you're going to capture that on camera. Wow. I mean, this is not a kid that was raised in Los Angeles who saw inside the actor's studio. This is somebody that came from Senegal 8 years ago, emigrated into Italy, and who had the normal life of a child. And to have these instincts of an actor is God-given. It's God-given, you know, it's amazing.
No, that's a great, great story. Now, did you ever consider casting anyone other than your mother for the role?
Never. You know, when I reread the book, you know, after 30 years, and I thought that this was an interesting one for us to work on together, you know, every line that was Madame Rosa's in the book, I heard my mother's voice. You know, it was my mother's Neapolitan side. It was her irreverence, her grit. That's why I had her actually play the role in Neapolitan, because I wanted her. When my mother speaks Neapolitan, her voice drops a tone. When she speaks English, it goes a little bit higher, because Neapolitan is a language, is a dialect born from the guts. Not from the heart, not from the head, from the streets. It's a street language. And so there is that grit. And I knew that if my mother was going to play that role, and the only person who could play that role like this is my mother, but not in Italian, my mother in Neapolitan. And so it was amazing, you know. And it's funny because when my mother then ended up reading the script, she heard her mother's voice in Madame Rosa. And a lot of things that Madame Rosa is really a combination of my grandmother and my mother.
Oh man, I love you, dude. I love your energy, man. Great. I could talk to you all night, but I gotta go. But before I jump out, congratulations once again. I know the song is up for a nomination. The film's up for, a lot of things are up for a nomination. Where are you watching? Where are you celebrating? And who are you gonna be with?
Yeah, of course, with my family, of course, at home in Santa Monica. And I have Ibra. Ibra is also nominated as Best Young Actor. So, of course, we're on speed dial. We're on the phone. I told him, don't fall asleep. This is the first time that an adult tells a 13-year-old not to go to bed. Don't go to bed tonight. Stay up until 3 o'clock in the morning. No matter what happens, you're a winner because you've been nominated for the Critics' Choice. I'm not sure he realizes exactly because obviously, you know, but I'm telling him it's a big deal, Ibra. It's a big deal.
No, it is a big deal. Congratulations on all the film success. Thanks a lot. I really, man, I'm loving your energy, man. I'm ready to go now. I'm ready to watch right
Thank
now.
You, man.
I was wish I was with you watching.
I know you're gonna come. I'm sure you're in LA too. Come over.
Unfortunately, I'm not. I wish I were, but no. Thank you very much.
Oh, really? Man. Okay, but then I'm sorry. I'm then not. You can.
Next time. Thanks a lot, man. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. Stop. Bye.